Good afternoon, Nanda. We welcome you. We'll start within 10 to 15 minutes, Nanda. Right?
Name it.
Kavi, we'll wait for 5 minutes. Kavi.
The students okay, ma'am.
Welcome, Nanda, wholeheartedly. Thank you, Nanda, yes, for accepting our invitation. Yes.
Thank you, Ms. Thank you.
Nanda, we'll start within 10 minutes.
Yeah, okay, sure.
Thank you.
Kavya, you can start, Kavya.
Yes, ma'am, yes, ma'am. So I'm Kavya M, Students Union President of AIDED's team, welcoming you all. A very present, bright, warm afternoon to everyone present in today's session. Today is our first session in our Talkology Forum. So days are getting brighter with online classes and webinar. Yes, you heard it right. It's getting brighter with online classes and webinar because we all are growing technologically good. We all are nearing to that tech-savvy world. So days are getting even more brighter with God's blessing, right? So let's seek God's blessing and start this occasion. Prayer song of our college.
Satyavritam, Satyaparam, Trisatyam, Satyasya Yonim Nihitam Cha Satye, Satyasya Satyam, Trita Satya Netram, Satyatmakam, Tvam Sharanam, Prapannaha, Gunanukatane, Shravanaukataya, Hastau Chakarmasu, Manastava Padayo, Smrityam Shirastava, Nivasa Jagat Praname, Drishti Sada, Darshane Subhavatanu.
Gathered here for the first session of our very own Talkology Forum. So what's the purpose of our forum? It is a platform to enhance the public speaking skills. So we can have so many ideas and thoughts, but we don't have the communication skill to communicate. It's going to be a failure. So to avoid all those, we have our Talkology Forum to take our communication skills to next level. So we are having this forum for you people. It's free of cost. We all can have this forum for improving our communication skills and our oral skill set. So now I welcome our principal ma'am to share a few words.
Good afternoon to all of you who are here, and a special welcome to Nanda. I'm very proud to say that she's the daughter of our senior faculty, Dr. Vijaya from Mathematics Department, and it's a pleasure to have Nanda with us also today. If you just look into her profile, she's an architect, but then her passion is also towards short story writing also. So it is really surprising to see an architect whose vision would be to give new designs and ideas to concentrate on short story also. In fact, I have read one of her short story also, and the way she has presented her thoughts sequentially is also very impressive. So what I would like to now impress upon all of our students is that you should also take her as an example, and not only concentrating on the domain expertise, right? She's an architect, but then just look into what is the passion she has got also. So once you are able to pen down your thoughts as a series of words and series of sentences and start writing, I think that would be this one. If you ask me to give a writing one paragraph think I have to think, I would have to spend some, say, some 2 hours before I get a good paragraph writing also. But nowadays, I think students are able to get the skill amongst themselves. But once again, it is the passion which is within you, which will help you to develop this skill. And really, I am very much happy that Ms. Nanda is here with us to share her, for a budding short story writer to come forward to share her thoughts. It is also very, it is not easy, right? Nobody would be forthcoming in coming and talk, sharing their thoughts at a budding age also. So really, I need to appreciate her for having come forward to share her thoughts about how to write this short story or how to develop your passion. And it's really very interesting. And I hope there would be more budding artists from our college after hearing your talk also. So I welcome Nanda amidst us, and a warm greetings to all my dear students who are here to listen to her and to take this Talkology forum to the next level also. And a special mention to Dr. Beena, who is also instrumental in making this forum happen, right? She always used to insist that students should be very capable in this public speaking forum, which is very, very important nowadays, right? And I think we have started it with a promising note with Nanda amidst us. And greetings to all of you and best wishes to all. And I do want more number of such programs to happen also. Thank you.
Thank you for your warm words, ma'am. Now we will have a short look at our speaker of the day. She's an architect by profession and a creative person by passion. She's an avid reader and writer. She works on creating and translating visual content along with penning down narratives and some of the blog pieces. She hopes to understand the different mediums of communication through art and prose, thereby taking the conversation forward. She has worked in many fields, and some of the important things to be put on spotlight is that she's a winner of the short story, which is a competition Spotlight Stories. Which has been published by the Brown Box Magazine, which is an online publication. He's also the in-house writer of the magazine, The Brown Box. And she's a writer. She's a column writer in Talking Cities of Madras Inherited. And as a blooming youngster in this 21st century, she's working on some of the independent projects, which is Bluegraph Press, and the next is My Overflowing Cup of Emotions, which title makes us all understand that how passionate she is about sharing her ideas and thoughts. So who else can be a perfect person for the first session than an youngster? So with no further ado, let's welcome the speaker of the day, Nanda Palnidurai. We welcome you, ma'am.
Good afternoon. Thank you so much for your lovely words. So I would first of all start by expressing my gratitude to Mrs. Beena for reaching out to me and giving me this opportunity to take this forward. Also the whole management of STNB Vaishnav College, and especially the principal, for your kind words. It really does make me feel good to hear it from a third perspective. I also want to thank all the organizers who've come forward to put together this event. I also specially like to extend my gratitude to the head of the Max department and my mom, Dr. Vijaya, without who I wouldn't have been acquainted with all these lovely people. And lastly, and most importantly, I would want to thank all the participants who have made it a point to be here in this event. So that, I think, is one of the things that I very strongly believe in, is to show up for yourself. Because it might seem very small or trivial, because it's just a Zoom webinar, you just have to connect to your internet and just go on with a link. But that by itself, I think, is the first step that you do just by showing up. So that is undeniable, of course. So I just hope that by the end of this, I can give you, just maybe lack for a better word, a gentle push to follow your stride. So on a very formal note, hello and welcome to my session on Right to Speak Up, A Way of Upskilling. Will I be able to share my screen? Okay. So I will just go ahead and share my screen. Yeah, I hope this is visible to everyone.
Yes, Nanda, the screen is visible.
Yeah, okay, thank you. Okay. So first, before I move on to the main topic, I think it is quite necessary to talk a little bit about my journey in general, just to provide an overall context. So here I have a very simple representation. So the myth of a straight journey. And it is quite a direct image, and I think it will convey the very simple message that I'm trying to put forth. So from my experiences, as well as exposure outside my own, I have sort of developed a strong understanding that, you know, seemingly great things do not necessarily happen in a straight line. What I mean by that is that the rule book that defines like activities that we do, as simple as they don't, are not as linear from A to B, and they don't, might not necessarily work in the same way. So to illustrate this point, I would say, my life in most parts was sort of on autopilot. I did my schooling, undergrad, postgrad, right after the other. While I did have enough opportunities and, you know, enough freedom to explore what I wanted, I would, in hindsight, say that it went on in an automatic progression. So what I mean here is that I definitely had dreams for the future in terms of envisioning my life as being big, inspiring, happy, worthy of what I was doing, all these great adjectives. But obviously the link to that was missing in terms of how do I get to that was the big question there. So here, so what basically happened was, I think there was a very obvious split between essentially two things. So one was the comfort and safety from the habits and the routine that I had. So when you go on autopilot, you just do the things that, you know, you develop over time. You don't consciously develop them, but, you know, you go to school and then you come back, you do your work, and then, you know, it's the next day. And so this, I think, by itself contributes to the comfort and safety. That was one side. And the other side is obviously your thought on, you know, how do you get to the big life? How do you get to a life that is... you know, you do big things. So that by itself, I think, led to confusion, frustration. So this obvious split was increasingly there. So a point of conflict arises here because these two circles by itself, I think, are their own separate identities, because one is the stuff that you're already doing, but it is not essentially matching with the stuff that you want to do. So yeah, and again, to add on to that point, I think I was very much in the early 20s, and that by itself, I think, comes with a lot of issues, such as, say, like peer pressure, wanting to do well, wanting to figure out stuff. How do you get to that point? So even without the turmoil happening, I think being in your early 20s, that itself is a huge issues. So with the inner turmoil, you can kind of understand the whole process. Yeah, so I think the point of conflict is just variations of these different questions to all of us. Say, where do you start? What skills do you have? Are you good enough with those skills, or do you even develop those skills? So these are some of the questions that I think all of us tackle, especially starting with 20s. So yeah. Here, so I think this is one of the main things that I was able to learn by this whole process, is because I think all of this, take it the skill, take it a relationship that you want to build, you really have to put in the effort, right? So it's very similar to, say, a potted plant. You know that it requires enough sunlight, it requires good source of water, it needs nutritious soil, and these are the basic things that will keep it alive, right? But along with that, you also have your the person who's taking care of it would have to have intention, responsibility, care, participation, some of these things together. So I think only then would the plant strive, right? So I think it's the same with the skills that you want to develop, or any relationship that you want to develop. You obviously have to put in the effort, and this is where I think this is one of the things that you very clearly see in many places, but also very, very important lessons that I was able to zero in on at the end, was that what I invest is exactly what I receive. So what I put in is what I get. So yeah, so this brings me back to the point where I started by saying that, you know, the straight journey is a myth. So I would define my journey as being a very non-linear progress. And this is somewhat you know, representation of the same. So yeah, work in progress is me defining myself, because no matter where you are, you might be someone who's just starting out, who's just, you know, noticing things and you want to do, build up your skills. Or you might be someone who's on the journey, who's started with it and who's on the way, but we are all work in progress. So this is one word that I really like to define myself when I have to bring up, and it goes very well with the, you know, journey as well. Okay, so we can start with confidence in a skill. So how do you develop confidence in any skill? So, and particularly, you know, we can talk about, say, writing or reading. So here, the next picture, I'm not sure if you'll be able to understand just by how it looks. So I will just make a small explanation for it. So here I am trying to sort of say that if you take any skill, this can be taken as the path that you would have to go to develop a skill, to gain confidence in the skill that you already have. You know, any of those, you can take this as the common path, but you can always say the path is, you know, it's inundated, it's up and down. You have highs and you also have lows, and also each part of the journey is different, right? So, and all of us, particularly when we want to develop a skill, we are in different portions of this very same line, right? Somebody might be at the start, somebody might be somewhere in the middle. So I think this whole point of being able to develop your confidence comes from the point of you identifying where you are. So that plays, I think, the first role to really understand is to identify yourself where you stand, so that you can understand how to take it forward. So let's start by looking at maybe writing as a skill. So what kind of a writer are you? So again, we have these different examples, right? Like I explained, you might be somebody who's just noticing, who's just gotten into the habit of wanting to write. You might be someone who is an avid reader, but has not really ventured into writing. Or you might be someone who has quite an experience in writing, who's been maybe keeping up a blog, doing journaling, something like that. So there are different types of in this journey that you have, right? So here, I think these are some of the points that I would maybe recommend and suggest in helping to develop a skill. So you have points such as, say, the learning process. So the learning process is obviously, I would equate it to a learning curve. So the more that you keep doing it, the more you understand the process. So if you're new to it, there are so many chances and it's more likely that you might get frustrated in, you know, there's so many variables in trying to keep a habit, in trying to develop a routine, in trying to just sit down and write. So, but as you go, obviously you get the learning curve as you go. So that equates to learning process. And so next is read like a writer. So here, again, to be a writer, I think this was one of the very important lessons that I was able to, you know, after a while I learned, and I still struggle with it, reading through books and any content that I read, but with a perspective of a writer. So for example, if you read through a book, I think on a very general note, how do you go about it? We just, you know, analyze the story, we enjoy the story, we have our obvious opinions about it. And by the end of it, you obviously have, you know, whether you like it or you don't, you have that sort of a look onto it, right? But when you say read like a writer, it means that you look at the story from how the writer would have written it. So for example, if a particular chapter ends a specific way, then you think about why the writer chose to end it that way. Or is there a certain pace that it is going by in terms of, is it a very, are certain, the characteristics, why are they trying to display certain characteristics that are being displayed in the book? So basically it is you getting into the head of the writer. And this really, really helps because when you try to pen down your own words, all this analysis makes sense to you because you would have gotten into that practice of analyzing like text as a writer. So this is a very important point. Then comes finding a community. Again, this is also, I think, one of, you know, it makes the whole process very sustainable because I think on a very large picture, writing or even reading to an extent is kind of lonely, right? You do it and you obviously gain joy out of it, but it's still something that you do alone. So it is definitely a must, or I wouldn't say a must, but it's definitely a good thing for you to find somebody to, you know, a writing group or a reading group. Or I know how difficult it is in finding somebody like that or even a group like that. And, you know, there are also a lot of chances that even after you find a group, it probably won't go in the direction that you want it to go because it's all like a different kind of like work. But that is definitely a point. And I think that is one of the reasons that you should actively try to reach out to people. You know, people that you even find maybe say online or, you know, you meet in some maybe organized events. It's always good to keep in touch with these people just for the idea of you finding a community. And then comes learn to embracing constructive criticism. So again, this also plays a huge role because I think, you know, when you're creating a story, when you're putting anything in the creative field, I think when you put out your art, when you put out your words, it's almost like you are having this baby of your own, right? It's so special to you because it's come from you. So I think it's very natural for us to, you know, when you get any criticism, constructive criticism, it is natural to get defensive because obviously you spent all this time and energy and you've created this. But then again, when you have this list of people that you think genuinely mean good and this community that is, you know, willing to help you, then definitely it would make sense for you to develop this habit of taking constructive criticism. Then comes spending time to explore the different writing styles that is out there. So this is not exactly genre. Of course, genre is, I think it's a very basic thing that is recommended to everyone who reads, just explore genres. See if you like thrillers, see if you like, you know, light reads. All of that is different. What I meant to say here was that when you start looking out for different things or when you get exposed to different kinds of, you know, the ways that it can be written. For example, I recently came across this way of writing where they usually combine like art and writing, and they do illustrated journaling. So basically, you wouldn't call that art, you wouldn't call that straight hardcore writing, but in a way, it's an amalgamation of both. So in such a way, if you keep exploring, I'm sure that you would come across certain things that interest you. Then comes working on developing a habit and setting a routine. And this is as much as it's an age old saying that you set a time and you set a routine, but it is an invaluable piece of advice, because that is definitely going to like help you sit and get it done. Even if it's for 10 minutes, even if it's for 15 minutes, I think it's going to like help you a lot in the longer run. Then comes finding your authentic voice. So what I mean by this is that I always know that we have our own voices, right? We have our own very unique voices because of our very unique set of experiences and the consequent feelings and emotions that you go through. So we do all have very unique voices. And I think when you come across with like writing, it's very important to put forth that authentic voice. For example, if you had read any of my stories or any of my writing, it's something that I'm practicing to do best at the moment. So I try not to shy away from using, this Indian-ness in the stories. It was a different story when I was smaller. I was, totally pulled into this Western world, and I never used to use any words that were remotely Indian. But at the moment, I try to inculcate that as much as possible. So if there is Indianness, if there is some local, flair that you want to bring to your writing, then you should definitely do that, because that is you. That is you on paper. So then it's the same, kind of extends into the same as using your experiences and imagination. So again, I think using your experiences is a good start point to write any type of content that you want to write. So especially it works with fiction. If you want to write fiction, you can use your experiences as a start point. And obviously you would have to add in your imagination, right? Then, and last again is practice. So again, time old saying, but invaluable. It's just not going to get better if there is no time and effort that you're putting in. So even if it is a very minimal time that you can put in, you still have to do it. And this doesn't have to be in any sort of prerequisite, doesn't come under any rules that you'd have to spend an hour doing it. How much of a time that you can spend and however frequently that you can spend is all for the best. So these are just a few, these are not really recommendations or suggestions, maybe a few things that I would want to remind, somebody who is willing to take this journey and who's interested in writing. So some of the things are, you are a writer. So no matter what, let's say that you've just written, 5 lines, or you've just written a very short piece about something, or it doesn't even have to be fiction. You just saw something or you just experienced something that day and you just penned it down in your diary. I believe that you're still a writer. So stop worrying about doing it wrong. There is no right way or wrong way to do it. Of course, there are certain things that when they say, it makes it easy, but there are no rules. You can go about it the way that you defined it to be. So also, it would make sense for you to come back to this origin point to think about, why do you write? What do you want to get out of it? So I think certain times you're so lost in the process, and especially let's say it is tied to you doing a project of your own, or it's tied to you some sort of freelancing in some commercial way. If it is tied in that way, then obviously I think if there comes a point where you get so flustered because you forget the work that you're doing, you forget the writing that you're doing, because there are bigger, top hurdles on you. So I think one point that we can always come back to is just reflecting certain times when you are kind of losing sight is, why do you have to write and what are you trying to get out of it? So like I said, again, time spend time doing it and nurturing it is from the potted plant example that I showed previously. It's what you put in that you get. If you're not going to, you know, spend the time, or if you're not going to give it the effort, then what you get out of it is going to reflect the same. So nurturing it is the best way to go. The next point is remembering the compliments and the good moments. This is something that I have very recently started doing, is that, you know, certain times it gets hard and you're not very sure, again, losing sight, and you're not very sure where you're going. At this point, I think it is very, it gives you a lot of warmth if you can remember the compliments or the good moments. You know, you can make some sort of project out of it. You can, you know, not even project in a big sense, maybe just pen down stuff on post-it notes, or you can, you know, put it on a piece of paper, you can put it on a chart, you can stick it somewhere that you can see, so that when you lose sight of something, where you can always look at it and you can be reminded that you are doing good work and it is possible for you to, you know, get through it or sail through it. So, and the last point is stop shooting down ideas or trying to be original. So this is, again, I think one of the very common things a lot of us face, because I've heard this point being spoken at by a lot of my friends as well, because, you know, you have an idea in your ops, you immediately think about whether it makes sense, whether it would, you know, look good, whether it'll be profitable, whether profitable in the sense, if you have, say, an Instagram following, you think about if you would have followers by it, or you think about if it'd be sellable in India. So automatically that thought comes into our mind, especially in this time that we are, right? So, but I think that, you know, you should still jot down all those ideas, maybe have, again, like some sort of, you know, small book or a post-it note or some papers that you can write it down. And I'm sure like some of those ideas have the potential to be made into actual big projects. And trying to be original is, again, one of the things we always worry about, you know, being original. Especially I've come across this a lot when I try to write a story. Sometimes I worry if I'm talking about a subject that it's, that has been talked about a lot, or those thoughts do come in, those kind of intrusive thoughts. But the point is that the most probably the theme that you're trying to think of, or the story idea that you've been trying to think of, has already been like written before through hundreds of like years. But then what makes it unique is obviously because only you have the lens that you have, because nobody has those experiences that you had. So in at the end of it, it is original by its own. So you don't have to worry about it not being original. I think you should just go for it. So, and what are some tangible things you could do to move forward? So here we've looked across some suggestions and maybe, you know, some general common stuff. So here I tried to see if I can give you some pointers as to what you can do to take it forward or to develop what you're trying to imbibe the skill. So I would say look up for competitions, participate as much as you can. So here, when I say, obviously, since we're talking about writing, there's a lot of actual competitions that are being held like throughout the year. You have online publications and magazines, you have separate literary agencies conducting their competitions, you have bigger competitions by, like, say, for example, we have the Common Health Writers. So such big names are there, as well as even tiny names. You don't have to be, if you're not confident enough to go forth with a bigger competition, you could always try out for something simple. Always keep out on the lookout. I would personally suggest, this is something that I do, you know, I have like an Excel sheet of my own where I just put in the stuff that I come across. So if I see certain agencies or certain, you know, pages announcing like competitions, I note it down so that it can go into the Excel sheet and so that I can sort of browse through it later. So that's one of the ways that you can do it. Look for it and try to store it somewhere so you can always revisit it and make it a point to take it forward. So one is that. Then we go through, browse through for workshops and classes. So now, especially in my opinion, I think that I see a lot of, quite a lot of literary, you know, organizations trying to organize workshops and like, classes. I see a lot about different genres as well. You have about fiction, nonfiction, no matter what it is. You have blog writing. So you can specifically look for workshops and classes that are being conducted. And again, try to, when you come across something that, you know, similar, try to accumulate it in one place so that you can revisit it and, you know, participate. And the next is applying to magazines and publications. So here you have a lot of chances when it comes to, like, again, like I said, fiction, nonfiction. You have essay writing, you have, you know, small pieces, you have flash fiction, micro fiction, poetry, so many avenues out there. And you just need these, you just need to collect the names of these places that are doing it and just regularly try to approach them with your work. And it will most definitely click more sooner than later. The next comes with writing a blog and creating an Instagram profile. So this is something that you can do without any sort of intrusion from external forces. You can just keep writing your blog. You can just be updating your Instagram profile. There are so many, especially at this time, I think, I see a lot of people putting forth their Instagram profiles. They write out pieces, you know, and that does like pick up. And why this is a great opportunity is because it can translate to you doing work sort of religiously. So when you are, you know, going to the next point, when you're trying to create a portfolio, creating a portfolio is basically, for example, having samples of your work. So this, you writing a blog or you having your Instagram profile or you having any such like outlets can sort of directly translate into you having your own portfolio. And the more quality pieces that you have, the more chance you have of, you know, getting finalized for whatever you are pursuing. So that is with that. And the last one is participating in challenges. And this, again, I think it's a step down from the competition level because challenges, you see a lot of, for example, people on, you see a lot of people on YouTube, you see a lot of people on Instagram. So basically they're referred to as booktubers and bookstagrammers. So they post a lot of you know, information on such challenges. They have read-alongs, they have write-alongs. So there's so many avenues that you can do if you just have to, you know, you just have to start exploring. So these are the some of the tangible things that I could think of. So next we can move on to a reader. So what kind of a reader are you? Like I was telling before, I think the same model extends to the reader as well. So you might be somebody who's just on the verge of starting, or you might be somebody who's well-versed and who's into, you know, as a full routine. So it depends on where you are and you trying to develop your confidence or your skill. Obviously it depends on the place that you are in right now. So we will just go through some of the recommendations that I thought of. So setting time for a routine, again, just like writing, you have maybe can set a time for a routine. I personally am not the kind of person who at the moment adheres to a time schedule. But it's more or less kind of sporadic for me, though I do it regularly, but the timing is not really something that I set to. But if you are starting out, it's definitely something that would be of great help to you because it in a way forces you to make the habit. So then comes making a list. So again, by now, you would have to get, you know, a better glimpse of me liking to make lists. Making lists is one of my like hobbies. So here, making a list refers to, you know, you can put up your goals, you can put up your to be read lists, so that it's just, I think, in a way, putting something on paper and you having accountability for it, so that when you, you know, even if you're not doing it and you kind of chance upon it, you'd get reminded that you did set a goal for it at some point and you did want to read all of these books. So there's more chance for you to maybe get into it, at least at the time when you revert back. So it's always good to have a list. So next we move on to, trying to see if you can create an experience around it. So this also pertains to the kind of to the schedule that you're trying to do, the routine that you're trying to create. So this involves space that you can create, or maybe this, you know, you can have your own corner, you can have your own, it doesn't have to be extravagant, obviously. It can just be your balcony, it can just be, you know, somewhere near the window, it can be your terrace. So some place that you would automatically think, you know, you get accustomed to that space as being your reading space. So then comes the points of setting a goal, and if you want to make it a challenge, and also finding a community. Again, it greatly helps if you have a community, because when you are kind of slouching down, that's always good if you have a community who's backing you up. You know, they will be able to at least give you some inspiration to be back on track. It's always okay to take a break, but then, you know, when you need that sort of push, it's there. Experiment finding a format that works for you. Like all of these points, I think equates to that, finding a format that works for you. And starting with audiobooks, podcasts, videos, if you're new to the habit. So this is something that I think not at the moment, but a little while back, there was a lot of debate about, you know, if you're listening to an audiobook, is it actually reading the book? But then you set your rules. So if, especially if you're starting out and you have a little bit of trouble with like going across or developing that skill, it's okay to start with an audiobook. You can, or a podcast, or even just YouTube videos about the book, to just get familiarized with this process of reading so that you can a little bit easily get to it the next time. So next comes subscribing to online magazines and content. So here, magazines basically, I think, give you different kinds of outlets. You're not exposed to this, you know, one type of writer that you've read, or one type of genre that you've read. I think subscribing to different magazines will help you also get a little bit exposure on like what is happening at the moment, and you know, kind of catch up to it. So there are so many magazines that are even like free. You don't have to even pay for them at the beginning. So that is, I think, something that helps a lot. Next, you have following bloggers, booktubers, and bookstagrammers. Like I said before, I'm pretty sure we use social media almost every day. On our phones, we have YouTube, Instagram, Facebook. So, and there is this separate movement where, for example, on Instagram, like I said, there are bookstagrammers. So their whole profile is set to basically update you with information on books and everything that's related to like books. So I'm sure even if you follow like, say, five of them, you would be like, when you go on to your profile, you'd be bombarded with the content that they put out. So I think you will be in that loop of what's happening at the moment. And I think it would also give you a little bit incentive to at least look through what they are talking about. So that is always a good way. So next comes trying your hand at reviews. So this extends also to reading and translating it to writing. So if you are, you have this already set routine and you've been reading for a while. So writing a review is something that I think will help also, I think, you know, gather your thoughts about the book once you've read. It'll make you a little bit more sharper when you're reading through. And I think it'll also definitely help you because you're translating it into writing practice. And again, at the end is practice, because nothing else can obviously replace that one word of practicing. So no matter what you do, however you can do it, try to practice as much as you can. So here, just a few things to remember. So it's okay to have your way around it. There are no rules. It is perfectly okay to pick out smaller books, short stories to read. So I know of like famous bookstagrammers and bloggers and people who have this whole, you know, they spread out like updates and content. I know that a lot of them very particularly pick out books that are like short stories, or, you know, they're anthology series, or they go for smaller books. So there is no any sort of shame around it. If you have to pick out a smaller book, you can always start with that. And try to minimize annotations at the start. So annotations is something that you know, you read through a book, for example. So you would basically maybe underline a point, you would write down a question, you would maybe write down your doubt. When you're reading the book and you're thinking out to yourself, okay, why is this happening? Or what has this character done to that character? So you annotate your book, or you maybe use post-its to stick on the book, right? So, but at the start, it's definitely something that can be minimized, because in the process of going forth with the habit, it becomes more important to just establish that habit, first of all. And at the end, it is okay to abandon a book that is not working out for you. Again, you set your rules. There is no other way around it. So here again, what are some tangible things that you could do to move forward? So here, I think some of it definitely, it kind of coincides with the writing that I was telling you about. So here again, you can look up for challenges, because like I said, people put out a lot of challenges talking about read-alongs and such. So you can definitely look out for those things. Then we have browse through for book clubs, book communities, and book-related events. So this can be done just by a very simple Google search. You just have to put in your locality, you just have to put in your city, and you would definitely get information about it. I think there is a site called LBB in Chennai. So they make it a point to update the events regularly. So you can definitely check that out, or you can, you know, very simple Google search would do. Explore different types of writing to see which ones you like, that is a given. And read from magazine subscriptions. Like I said, it will sort of extend your horizon, if that makes sense. Okay, so technology. So like I was saying, the biggest advantage that lies at your disposal to use is technology. So here I'm assuming some of the common apps that you would use every day are social media apps, are Facebook, Instagram, maybe YouTube, maybe Pinterest. I'm not sure about the rest. So maybe these are some of the apps that you use every day. So how can you make use of this? So let's consider Instagram for example. So basically what you do is you look out for profiles, people, pages that offer you what you need. That is, so they put out information of like competitions and challenges. There are literary initiatives that you can look out for. And bloggers, and also official pages of literary magazines and agencies would put out a lot of updates on all of these things that you could make use of. So following these pages would give you a lot of information, because I think that is one of my very primary sources of, updates that I get from. And also the algorithm plays a role. It once you start looking for these things, and once you're continuously keeping up with these posts, it makes you it shows up all these related content, right? So it, for me, it has worked out in a very positive way, and I think it would do that same effect for you as well. So here I'm just sharing few of the resources that I just took up from my own collection. So here are some of the magazines that I have come across, and all of these magazines accept, they accept submissions. They obviously, the timing differs. They have a quarterly, early, and also how they accepted the method and all it differs. But all of these are just some examples. And you have organizations such as Bound India, you have Hustle Post Academy. So Bound India is basically, is a literary organization, and they have the sole purpose of they conduct like classes, they do, for example, manuscript reading. So that is one of the things, like agencies that you can follow, because they continuously sort of put up the content, and it might coincide with what you are in need of. So, and Hustle Post Academy is again a sort of agency organization that creates like content, and they also conduct a lot of workshops and classes. So you can make a note of that. And here are some of the bloggers that I personally like and follow on some of my social media platforms. Some of them, they also have their YouTube channels as well as their Instagram profiles. I can make sure to like share this maybe separately to you in a more sort of organized form. So these are some of the accounts that I follow. You can definitely give them, check out their thing. And you can also, if you are interested, follow them back so that you get updates and, you know, you get something out of them as well. Yeah, so I would like to finish my talk with this. I had a great time going about this because I think it was very reflective for me to think about how I go about my process. So I really enjoyed it. And I would also like to thank everybody involved in this for giving me this opportunity. And on a last note, I would also be willing to help out if somebody needs some sort of help with, you know, they're serious about writing or, you know, to go forth if I can lend my support and help. I would be happy to do that. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. So audience, if you're having some questions or any thoughts, you can share it in the comment box. In the chat box, yeah. Okay, we'll move on. Yes.
Yes, Kavya, can I?
Yes, ma'am, definitely.
Ms. Nanda, I would say it was an extensive and comprehensive presentation. I just have wanted to ask you two questions. Even those questions you really answered the way you really presented it. I wanted to ask about more of the magazines to be really helpful for our students to take up.
Yes,
you made it very clear on your last slide. And this, you know, icing on the cake is like you really wanted, you are ready to collaborate with our students also. It's really amazing, Ms. Nanda. Thank you so much for your time and the effort that you've put in. Thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Really benefited out of your presentation, Ms. Nanda. Thank you once again.
Thank you, ma'am. I'm very glad to be of help. Thank you.
Bina, once again, right, so Nanda, we would appreciate if you can just list out the magazines where your short stories have come, that students would be able to read those, or if you can share the link with the students, I think it would be of help to them, right, to see how they can go about presenting their thoughts in the form of a writing also.
Okay, ma'am, I'll do that. I'll send it across.
Sure.
We have shared it, ma'am, actually.
Okay, fine. Okay.
Yes. Thank you.
So, yes, ma'am, we have read The Monsoons, The Indian Monsoons, your story. It was very interesting to see the slang of words you have used, the Tamil slang and the words and the touch you have given to the story. It was very exciting to see those words, to see a person writing with such taste. It was very happy to see. And this session was really an eye-opener to the young girls who are waiting to bloom as a writer, as a short story writer. So many girls have been reading many storybooks, novels, fictions, non-fictions, many things. But magazine was not on my bucket. To be very personal, it was very interesting to know that magazines have been helping you. We'll definitely try it. And the thing that you said, criticisms will be everywhere, but you have to take only the people who are really trying to push us forward with their criticism. That was definitely a good note. And as a reader and as a blooming writer, we all wish you a great success in your life and many more success to be added to it. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much for your very kind words, Kavya. It makes me feel really, really good. So I will keep trying to, do my writing and all that I want to do. And I really hope that all of you have, I was able to provide some sort of incentive for you to push yourselves a little bit, maybe forward. And I'd love to hear, stories from you guys as well. So keep me updated.
Thank you. And as you said, you gave us that gentle push towards our writing passion.
Thank you.
Now I welcome the Ms. Hasmat Shekina to propose the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Kavya. On behalf of our college, I extend a really hearty vote of thanks to our chief guest, Ms. Nanda Palanidurai, who spared time from her schedule to grace the occasion. Today, we had an opportunity to hear your thoughts, and this will surely be going to encourage us in the future events, ma'am. My gratitude to Sri Yasin Bhatsar, Chairman Cork Industries Trust, our college management committee members, Principal Ma'am, Vice Principal Ma'am of Aided and Self-Finance Stream, Union Bearers, teaching and non-teaching staffs, and I also thank Ms. Kavya, Student Union President of Aided Stream, for hosting the event gracefully. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, for making this occasion a successful one.
Thank you, Kavya. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Nanda. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much.
Shall we leave the meeting, ma'am?
Yes, Kavya. You can leave the meeting, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am.